Greetings. Thank you for your comment, brother. Brother, why did God in the Old Testament order every Amalekite to be killed mercilessly, and ordered even children of non-Israelites to be killed? Justify God's killings. Brother, there are several independent concepts which I encourage you to consider. First, I do not need to justify God. In fact, brother, for men to judge God is to try and set ourselves above God, our Creator. From the following, we see that God deals with His people as God sees fit. Jeremiah 18:6. Can I not, O house of Israel, deal with you as this potter does, declares the Lord? Behold, like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. Isaiah 45:9. Woe to the one who quarrels with his maker, an earthenware vessel among the vessels of earth. Will the clay say to the potter, what are you doing? Or the thing you are making say, he has no hands? Isaiah 64:8. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you our potter, and all of us are the work of your hand. Matthew 20:15. Do I not have the right to do as I please with what is mine? Or are you envious because I am generous? Romans 9:20. But who are you, O man, to talk back to God? Shall what is formed say of him who formed it, why have you made me like this? Does not the potter have the right to make from the same lump of clay one vessel for special occasions and another for common use? Second, God speaks about his plans and that he does create foreign nations and powers to chastise his people. That God is the creator, and he even created destroyers, whom we might think or judge are evil. Isaiah 10:5. How terrible it will be for Assyria, the rod of my anger. The club is in their hands. Isaiah 10:12. So it will be that when the Lord has completed all his work on Mount Zion and on Jerusalem, he will say, I will punish the fruit of the arrogant heart of the king of Assyria and the pomp of his haughtiness. This is God using the Assyrian, meaning the Antichrist, to chastise Israel. But it follows up with Isaiah 10:15. Shall the axe boast over him who hews with it, or the saw magnify itself against him who wields it, as if a rod should wield him who lifts it, or as if a staff should lift him who is not wood? Isaiah 54:16. Look, I have created the craftsman who blows on the charcoal fire and produces a weapon suitable for its task, and I have created the destroyer to cause havoc. Many times God uses nations as implements of judgment against his own people. But these implements of judgment will ultimately be destroyed after their use. Third, God knows the future, brother. Nothing that happens surprises God, because God is already in the future, even as we must imagine the future to have not yet happened. However, God occupies all times. That is a real brain twister for us poor temporal beings to fully understand. And God's knowledge does not require control any more than a person knowing past history. I did not control the crucifixion, yet I know it happened. I did not cause World War II, yet I know it happened. To me, these are in the past. Therefore, I may have knowledge without needing to have control. Knowledge of past events negates the need for control of those events. God exists at all points in time, and therefore all points in time are in the past to God. God exists this way because he is outside the dimension of time. When God gave commands such as killing all, even the livestock of a pagan culture, God, the maker of heaven and earth, was first exercising his right as creator. The wood project I create has no right to judge me, nor does the scrap of wood I discard after the project. Ultimately, I believe God is creating human spirits who will live with him eternally. And that likely raises a question in your mind about fairness. You assume God must have planned to damn some, but it is not required that any must perish for human beings to grow in righteousness. Proverbs 27:17, iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. Mutual edification does not require any to perish for us to grow. So one man sharpens another. So it is not required that any perish, yet God knows some will make that choice. John 3:19, this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and men loved the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light, and does not come to the light, for fear that his deeds will be exposed. Some men and women choose darkness because of their shame. And that likely raises the question in your mind, what about good people? The prophets revealed that no one is good by God's standard. Isaiah 64:6, but we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteous acts are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities or sins, like the wind, have taken us away. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:9, what then? Are we any better? Not at all. For we have already made the charge that Jews and Greeks alike are all under sin. This is equivalent to saying Jews and non-Jews, meaning all mankind. So according to God's message, there is no one who is righteous enough by themselves. Second, God may have been eliminating a future threat to his people, which we will never comprehend because the threat was eliminated. One such example in Jewish history is Haman. Esther 3:1. After these events, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, and advanced him and established his authority over all the princes who were with him. Haman was an Agagite, descended from Agag, the king of the Amalekites. The story of Esther comes from around 480 to 470 BC. As you noted, God had ordered all the Amalekites killed many years before. 1 Samuel 15:1. Samuel also said unto Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore hearken you unto the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and smite Amalek, and utterly destroy all that they have, and spare them not, but slay both man and woman, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. These events happened somewhere between 630 and 540 BC. So roughly 100 to 150 years before the events of Esther. Later on, and he, Saul, took Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive, and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag, and the best of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fatlings and of the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them, but everything that was vile and refuse, that they destroyed utterly. And roughly 100 to 150 years later, a descendant of Agag nearly exterminated the Jews. God knew, and God had a plan, but Saul disobeyed God. While all have a chance and opportunity to hear and accept the truth, decisions have consequences. Men who reject God and suffer consequences sometimes determine the fate of all of their descendants as well. In summary, men are not capable of accurately judging God because our information is limited and biased, and our position is as clay in the hands of the Creator. The alternative worldview of godless existence and evolution also suffers from a damning problem. A logically consistent view from evolution requires human beings to be worth no more than dogs, cattle, roaches and bugs, even grass or rocks. Any attempt to value humans above any other form of life is inconsistent and self-serving. When communism killed 70 million people under Stalin and 80 million people under Chinese communism, they did so because a human has no value. We actually see the eco-Nazis adopting a consistent position, giving mankind no more value than ants, rats, and ferns. But none yet dare address how godless natural selection and evolution produced something unnatural and destructive to evolution. Ultimately, a godless worldview is in no position to attempt to judge God either. Just my thoughts, brother. If we judge God for killing people, we must judge men's philosophies for killing people. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.